1959 Candidates Tournament. 8 grandmasters are competing for the chance to face world champion Botvinnik. Tal is at the top of his game. He's whipping through. Fischer became the youngest grandmaster in chess history to play in the Candidates Tournament. What a great achievement! Robert James Fischer started with e4, as usual. Tal's response is c5, Sicilian defense. Knight f3, d6, d4, c, d, knight takes d4, knight f6, knight c3, a6, the Neudorf variant, in which both grandmasters are quite familiar. Bishop c4, Fischer chose the continuation, which bears his own name. The bishop in square c4 puts good pressure on both the center and the opponent's kingside. e6. That's a pretty standard answer. So with this pawn wall, he is trying to diminish the opposing bishop's influence. Bishop b3. A prophylactic move. The bishop was on shaky ground in c4. With this bishop b3 move, it both avoided the b5 and queen c7 tempos. But that doesn't stop Tal from doing b5. And now he's coming with a concrete threat, b4, then knight takes e4. Fischer, however, ignored his opponent's request and continued with the f4 move. "So you're coming from the queen side, huh?" he said. "Then I'm coming from the center and kingside. Let's go." b4, knight a4, knight takes e4, and kingside castling. We're still in the opening, and things are crazy. First, let's try to understand why Fischer sacrificed the pawn. Tal has made a lot of pawn moves since the opening, and played for the second time with his knight, the only piece he developed. So we see that he is significantly behind in development. Meanwhile, Fischer developed many of his pieces and made kingside castling. But let's not forget that Fischer's e4 pawn was one of the most important pawns in his offense, giving him the upper hand. In addition, according to the character of the Sicilian defense, Tal's king may remain safe in the center for some time due to the large number of pawns in the center. And finally, I want to say that Tal may be consoling himself in terms of development, saying, "Yes, the knight in square a4 has joined the game, but it is in the board's corner." As a result, Tal may have perceived it as a semi-developed piece in his mind. Well, after the latest kingside castling move, guys, be sure to remember that in the Sicilian defense's continuation, you've made a significant investment in your bishop in f1, so you spent 2 tempos, and you have to build a game on this bishop, I mean, based on f5 advance. What can f5 do? To begin with, if the e6 pawn can be exchanged, both the bishop's cross and the f vertical will be opened, allowing the rook and bishop to put pressure on the f7 point. Here's Fischer wants to play f5. That's why Tal played g6, to stop his opponent's f5 advance. But young Fischer isn't going down without a fight. He's sacrificing another pawn with the f5. Of course, because he didn't want this bishop's way to be open, here, Mikhail Tal played g takes f5. And guys, please remember this. If you played the opening aggressively, as Robert James Fischer did, you must hurry, because he has now sacrificed 2 pawns and is materially behind. So you have to open the game as soon as possible before you let your opponent recover. It is critical for the leading side in development. Fischer does the same, and he takes it a little further and makes the knight takes f5 move. This time, he's making a much more serious sacrifice, a night sacrifice. But is this sacrifice acceptable? Tal didn't do that. Let's take a quick look. If the night sacrifice was accepted, the bishop would be like a beast. And here, the queen d5. The last piece we want to see in the center is the queen. Now give the mate, give the rook. Even if rook a7 was made, it would be countered by queen d4, and one of the two rooks would be lost. That's why, against knight takes f5, Tal didn't accept the knight sacrifice. What do you think he did? Rook g8. Yes, the rook g8 move. So as Fischer comes with all his power, Tal calmly plays the rook g8 as if nothing has happened. I mean, if there was another player here in Tal's place, he'd lose control, because Fischer's coming at his opponent. But Tal is so good at sacrifice games that no one in chess history can hold a candle to him. He also knows how to defend. So what does the rook g8 move mean? First of all, Tal told us this. I'm giving up my kingside castling. My king will stay in the center throughout the game. All right, but the f7, beware. The f vertical is also very sensitive as it is opened. This place needs to be defended. That's why Tal is preparing the rook a7 defense. But as you can see, to prevent both rooks from being on demand, he played rook g8 against rook a7. But if he can defend his position, if he can survive this attack, he can also use his rook to attack the opposing king. So, it could also be used as an offensive move in the future. Against the rook g8, Fischer makes a bishop sacrifice with bishop d5. Would you look at this? He gave both pieces to the pawns with his own hand. It's an incredible position. But after bishop d5, the bishop sacrifice cannot be accepted. Again, the queen would be centralized, and you would have to say goodbye to a knight or a rook. For this reason, against bishop d5, Tal played rook a7 to protect his rook, which is what he thought, and against rook a7, bishop takes e4, e takes f5, bishop takes f5, rook e7. It's a very original idea. With the idea of a rook elevator, he can both defend the king's open line and attack at some point. Fischer continues with the bishop takes c8 move. Yes, he has exchanged his bishop, which he has played numerous times since the opening, for his opponent's bishop, which has made no moves. Although he may be criticized in this regard, Fischer's goal is to increase the pressure on the d6 pawn. So after the queen takes c8, that pawn was left undefended, and now, with the bishop f4, he wants to take the pawn with bishop and then pose serious threats. But beware. Bishop f4 actually means the capture of the knight in the corner. How's that? Queen c6. Give the mate, give the knight. There's nothing you can do about it. You have to defend the mate. Queen f3. And now, queen takes a4. But beware. Fischer sacrificed his knight, but in the meantime, he completed his development. Tal still needs to go a long way. And now, against bishop takes d6, Mikhail Tal has suggested a queen exchange again. Queen c6. Because his king is in the center, he has a material advantage, and if his queen can be exchanged, he will win easily. Here, bishop takes e7. If Fischer had taken the rook, Tal would have been very happy. Because the queens would be exchanged, he would take the bishop, and, in the case of the knight and bishop versus the rook, two minor pieces are frequently considered superior. That's why, against queen c6, Fischer plays bishop takes b8 to avoid exchanging the queens. And now, Tal played queen b6 check, returned to king h1, and took the bishop. Queen takes b8, but the queens are still on the board. This is very important to Fischer. Queen c6 check, rook d7, rook a e1, bishop e7. We can say that Fischer is panicking here. Rook takes f7, and he made a rook sacrifice. He's not taking the rook immediately against king takes f7. He's checking first and waiting for his opponent to see if he can find the right answer. Of course, Tal finds the right answer, king f8. And against that, now Fischer is taking the rook. He sent the king to the f8 square so that Tal's rook could not defend from the 8th horizontal. That's the point. And now he wants a mate in one move. That's why queen d6. Of course, Fischer doesn't exchange the queens because he's back in material. Queen b7 to keep up the pressure on the opposing king, and rook g6 with the idea that the rook's path will not be blocked when the king arrives at the g7 square. Rook g6 and c3. Fischer's following a very correct strategy. He made a lot of sacrifices, but Tal defended perfectly. That's why Fischer is pursuing the pawn reduction strategy, which is the best way to get closer to a draw. If all of the pawns on the board are exchanged, and let's say the queens and rooks are also exchanged, even if the opponent has the advantage in bishops, this is a theoretical draw. Let's go ahead and exaggerate a little more. Consider the following scenario. Assume we exchanged all of the pawns on the queen side. In fact, Fischer loses both of his kingside pawns, and the opponent only has the bishop's advantage. This includes the h7 pawn. Even that would be a draw. Why? Because the h7 pawn's promotion square is the opposite color of his bishops. So, it's the wrong bishop pattern. So that's the case. Which is why Fischer is trying to exchange the pawns, because of inadequate material. Tal shouldn't do this. a5. He protected the b4 pawn. Queen c8. King g7. And after, queen c4. Now, bishop d8. Of course, the queen relied on the bishop's protection, and now that is no longer the case. The queen is free to join the attack. First, c takes b4. A takes b4. Against both, the queen d2 and the queen bishop battery, as well as potential threats to his king and pawns, Fischer played g3 here. So he's taking precautions in advance, but it opened the king's cross and led to the exchange of the queens with queen c6. Tal is very happy about it. Rook e4, queen takes c4, rook takes c4, and now he has protected the pawn with rook b6. What did we just say? Tal has to protect his pawns. King g2, king f6, king f3, king e5, and king e3. Of course, in a situation where the queens are on the board, bringing your king into the middle of the board like this will almost certainly result in checkmate. However, without queen, the king must be centralized and activated at the endgame. That's what both grandmasters do. Now, the bishop g5. Guys, here, if the king d3 move was made, with rook d6 and rook d2, Tal could have activated his rook perfectly. That's why, against bishop g5, Fischer played king e2. When it countered with the king d5, now the king d3 move can be play, because there's no rook d6. Bishop f6, rook c2. Of course, the pawn was on demand, so he protected it. The bishop is centralized with bishop e5. After rook e2 and rook f6, Tal is also trying to activate the rook. Rook c2, rook f3, king e2, rook f7, king d3, bishop d4, and against a3, what did we say? Tal must not exchange the pawns. That's why he's playing b3. Please remember that at the end of the game, this pawn will be the pawn that won the game for Tal. Now, if you leave your rook in the protection of the pawn until the end of the game, it will not be very pleasant. That's why, against b3, Fischer has to be active. Rook c8. When Tal took the b2 pawn, first rook d8, he pushes the king away from the center, king c6, and with rook b8, he demands the pawn. He'll have a better chance of a draw if he can take this pawn. However, Tal catches up in time after rook f3 and king c4, just as the pawn is about to be taken. With rook c3, he took the king away from the pawn. After king b4, king c7, Fischer moved his rook to b5 to protect it. After bishop a1, this passing pawn is unstoppable. To stop that, you must be given a lot of material. Fischer desperately made the a4 move, and he has left the game to the b2 move. Here's a little tactic. If Fischer had taken the undefended rook, the b1 would have come with a discovered check. So this is an important detail. Or the only option against b2. If the king a5 move was made, there would be the rook c1 counter move, and since Tal wants to promote, Fischer would have to lose his rook to the pawn. That's why Fischer has left the game to b2. Mikhail Tal won the candidates tournament with an excellent performance. Mikhail Tal faced Botvinnik a year later and defeated him to become the youngest world champion in chess history at the time. It's a great achievement. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you enjoyed this video, please like, leave a comment, and subscribe to this channel. And click on the bell icon to stay updated with my new videos. Hope to see you in the next videos. Take care.